10 Rillington Place. Once upon a time, I used to go to Rillington Place occasionally. Between 1965 and 1980, my sister-in-law lived just a few blocks away from it, in Lansdowne Crescent. And I would sometimes slip out of her flat, walk over to Ruston Close, as the street had been renamed, and shudder. I was exactly the sort of morbid rubberneck Solicitor Michael Eddowes feared, an ordinary member of the public, having no connection with the crime, but fascinated by its locale. Eddowes, one of the first people to take up the cudgels on behalf of the dead Timothy Evans, apparently made arrangements to buy the house when its lease fell in, with the aim of demolishing it so that it might never become a tourist attraction. Urban redevelopment beat him to it. In 1972, I went to America for a year. When I came back, the houses in Ruston Close had all been demolished. Only the high wall at the end of the road, with the old foundry chimney looming over it, remained. A year later, that had gone. And last time I visited the area, taking a break from Notting Hill Carnival, it was unrecognisable. Bartle Street, following the line of old Rillington Place, doesn't give the remotest impression of what it was like. I'm sorry it's gone. The old murder sites do give us an awareness of the darker side of human nature as reality, and I think it's better for us to face them than to sweep them away under the carpet. And 10 Rillington Place was the most sinister and atmospheric murder site I've ever seen, possibly excepting Swallow Gardens as approached at night from Chambers Street in Whitechapel, where Francis Coles was murdered under a gloomy railway arch in 1891. Rillington Place was a grubby little cul-de-sac. Two terraces of workers' cottages faced each other, three stories high indeed, but very small nonetheless, and run down. The little bay windows of the ground floor fronts lit pokey sitting rooms, about 12 foot square. The houses were of the deep London variety, where the front door opens almost directly onto the staircase, and a passage beside it has the ground floor rooms leading off, all to one side. First door on the right into the ground floor front room. Next door into the still smaller ground floor back room. A step down at the end of the passage into a minuscule lobby with standing room for one. And to your left, the door into the ground floor kitchen, which extends behind the wall facing you. To your right, a door out into the tiny backyard. Walk through the yard, past the kitchen window, and you reach the communal outhouses built onto the ground floor. The little wash house with copper, grate and sink, the outside lavatory beyond that. And beyond the lavatory, the scrubby little garden, traditional prerogative of the ground floor tenants. I don't think the most wildly optimistic estate agent would ever have called the Christie's cramped and grimy rooms a garden flat, however. The house would not be spacious for one family. As three flats, it offered what most of us would find unpleasantly overcrowded conditions. If you lived upstairs, you could rarely go in and out without coming across Mr. Christie, shuffling silently round the place in shirt sleeves, flannels, and plimsolls. He seemed ever present. His quiet, heavy wife lived in his shadow, and inside the house there was none of the gracious arm for his lady wife, hat raised to passing ladies, with which Reg Christie impressed his middle-class gentility on a working-class neighbourhood. The whole street was redolent of shabby depression. The grubby little houses, their dirty stucco cracked and peeling, faced each other over dull tarmac. At the end of the road, a high brick wall sealed it off. A squat foundry chimney, disused now the works had been taken over by a transport firm, loomed over the centre of the wall, swelling toward its base like a brick kiln, and gloomily dominating the street. Rillington Place felt like a trap. Back to this dismal setting came Reg and Ethel Christie, after the distressing excitement of the Evans trial. Reg, a constant visitor to his doctor, was in the surgery again, with back pains and diarrhoea. The revelation of his criminal record surprised the post office. It is against their regulations to employ anyone with previous form, and Reg lost his job as his reward for doing his civic duty. He found another, however, as a haulage clerk with British Road Services. And for a couple of years, he settled placidly into the routine of clerical life. His health picked up again. He enjoyed working in his garden, growing runner beans and hollyhocks. He enjoyed taking snapshots and having pictures taken of himself among his plants and with his beloved mongrel dog, Judy. He has been described as an amateur photographer, but his pictures show no interest in composition. Plain shots of family or friends standing smirking at the camera. He was unaware of the possibilities of using light and shade, and might best be described as a keen snapshotter. Christie's home might be small and seedy, but he was the master within it, and he should have been contented. Mr. Kitchener, the old railway man from the floor above, moved out, needing permanent care as his eyesight grew ever worse, and for a while the Christies had the whole house to themselves. The landlord was trying to sell it, but the memory of the murder in the top floor flat tended to frighten buyers off. One man who seriously contemplated buying the house chatted amiably with Christie as he looked it over. The murders didn't worry undertaker Ernest McNeil, but he was surprised to see Judy. "How on earth did those two bodies manage to stay in that washhouse without your dog smelling them all that time?" he asked. And Christie became quite snappish, saying he'd answered enough questions at the time of the trial and he wasn't going to answer any more. Ah, well, he was obviously a sensitive and emotional man, and it must have been quite a strain to be suddenly accused of murder by a young man he and his wife had tried to help in little ways. Mr. McNeil had tea with the Christies at one point, and concluded Reg was a weird bastard, showing off his snaps of himself in police uniform and his St. John's Ambulance Brigade certificates. Ethel, Mr. McNeil found pathetic. The Christies wanted to stay on as ground floor tenants, which was okay with Mr. McNeil, but Reg was also very keen to retain use of the garden, which Mr. McNeil wanted for his own use if he bought the house. In the end, he was put off buying 10 Rillington Place, when his surveyor reported that it was full of bedbugs. Mr. McNeil had already observed that it was filthy from top to bottom. But that didn't deter a new class of buyer. West Indian immigration was starting in the post-war years. The voyage of the Windrush had not yet started the great flood of migrants recruited by the Conservative government with the aim of providing coloured workers for menial occupations Britons didn't want. But West Indians who had served in the war discovered that England was, at that time, more racially tolerant than their own colonial islands. West Indian ex-soldiers settled in England, flourished, and encouraged their friends to come over and join them. Whereupon the quiet, polite, but firm racism endemic in Britain became known to them. In particular, it was difficult to find rented accommodation. "No coloureds, Irish dogs or children," was a common landlady's policy. And in consequence, those West Indians who could scrape up the money for deposits and mortgages might prosper by buying up cheap London housing and letting it out in rooms to their fellow countrymen. Jamaican Mr. Charles Brown bought No. 10 Rillington Place as just such an investment. The Christies were appalled. They had some small justification. If the little house was crowded when they lived there with Mr. Kitchener above them and the Evanses above him, it became far more crowded as Mr. Brown let rooms separately to West Indians in ones and twos. The black tenants were accustomed to sleeping in chattel houses, bursting at the seams on their island homes. No great discomfort, as the climate meant houses were used essentially for sleeping and eating, while most living was done out of doors in the sunshine. And they brought the gregarious habit of packed houses with them. But the Christies were both quite simply racist. Without knowing the first thing about them, they knew that black people were dirty, dishonest, and inferior. A pretty extraordinary piece of self-delusion, you may feel, on the part of a couple who were the longest-standing residents of a house that was explicitly filthy and riddled with bedbugs. That didn't stop Christie from visiting the Poor Man's Law Centre in Kensington, demanding protection from intrusion. The law could do nothing whatsoever about his silly and disgusting belief that there was something revolting about having to use the same lavatory as black tenants. The black tenants had an equal claim that the house was severely underprovided with sanitation for the number of occupants. and in the long run, it would be a very sick racist indeed who preferred peeing in the same pot with Reg Christie to sharing the facility with an honest black man. But for all his complaints about the coloureds moving in and taking over, Christie's health remained good for 2 years. Ethel seemed more profoundly racist than Reg. She moaned and complained the whole time about the presence of black people in the house. She claimed that they threatened her, and on one occasion she took one of her neighbours to court. No doubt, the immigrants, culturally among the world's most hospitable and cosmopolitan people, would nevertheless evince solid and unfriendly self-respect when confronted with intransigent hostility and grumbling from the ground-floor tenants. The Christie's discontent affected Reg conclusively early in 1952. Suddenly he was back at his doctor with his old complaints, tummy upsets, sleeplessness, headaches and backaches. All the things that show a disturbed and unhappy frame of mind, rather than an organically diseased body. Dr. Matthew Odess, who had treated Christie since 1938, sent him on to St. Charles Hospital for observation as an inpatient. He felt there must be some functional cause he could not diagnose in the recurrent small ailments keeping this decent, hard-working man from his employment. Dr. Heinz Howell reported back from the hospital that no underlying organic cause could be found. Christie was, in fact, highly neurotic, and his symptoms were all psychosomatic. Dr. Odess had to go on treating them with palliatives. Belladonna for the fibrositis, phenobarbitone for the sleeplessness and anxiety, kaolin and morph for the collywobbles. In July, Christie was referred to the Springfield Mental Hospital, where he told Dr. Dinshaw Pettit that his ill health started when Evans falsely accused him of murder, and was now exacerbated by the top of his house having been turned into a negro brothel. Dr. Pettit didn't pay much attention to these alleged causes. He concluded that Christie was severely psychologically disturbed, with repressed homosexuality high among his problems, and he felt he ought to come into the hospital as an inpatient. Christie refused, saying Ethel would be terrified alone in the house full of black men. And in August he stopped the treatment, saying he was now much better. At the beginning of December, he suddenly threw up his job with British Road Services. He told them he had a new and better job in Sheffield, where Ethel's family lived. This was quite untrue, and his move was reckless and irrational. He was only 54, he had no pension, no sickness benefit entitlement, no new job in sight. On December the 16th, Ethel's sister in Sheffield, Mrs. Bartle, got a letter from her in an envelope addressed by Reg with a note from him explaining that he was posting it as Ethel had no envelopes. Typically, Ethel was grumbling about how much she wanted to get out of Rillington Place and away from these people, a racist phrase anyone who's met white settlers in a black environment will recognise at once. For Christmas that year, the Bartles received a gift of writing paper and envelopes from Reg and Ethel, with a letter in Reg's hand saying that Ethel's rheumatism was so bad he had to write all the Christmas cards. A jolly little afterthought at the top of the letter exclaimed, "Don't worry, she's okay. I shall cook Christmas dinner." Around this time, some of the West Indians living upstairs noticed that Christie developed the habit of sprinkling Jay's fluid on the passage floor outside his front room. A belated attempt to clean up the place, perhaps? I don't suppose they regretted the fact that grumbling, racist Ethel was no longer in evidence. And they would certainly have been tolerantly unconcerned that various seedy-looking women made short stays with Christie in his flat. West Indians are given to amused delight at other people's sex lives, not prurient censoriousness. In January 1953, Mr. Hookway of Portobello Road, who had bought Evans's furniture, was invited to buy Christie's. Reg told him he was out of work and looking for a new job in Northampton. He was asking £15 for his sticks, but Mr. Hookway found them so rotten that he would only give £12. He was shocked to find how dirty and untidy Christie's flat had become. A real devil's kitchen, in his words. And he took away everything except an unspeakably filthy mattress, a kitchen table with two chairs, and a squalid deck chair, whose seat was not canvas, but widely meshed knotted cord, black with grime. At the beginning of March, a shabby young couple stayed 3 nights with Christie in his barely furnished flat. None of the neighbours paid any attention. On March the 20th, landlord Mr. Charles Brown came round to look at his property and was shocked to find Christie gone and an Irish couple, Mr. and Mrs. Riley, in possession of the ground floor flat. Christie had sublet to them the previous day, taking £7.13 as a quarter's rent in advance, and borrowing one of their suitcases to hold his photographs and some women's things. Mr. Brown pointed out forcefully that Christie had no right to sublet. He was already several weeks in arrears with his own rent, and though the Rileys could stay the night, they'd have to move out the following day. When the Rileys had gone, Mr. Brown arranged that one of the top-floor tenants, Mr. Beresford Brown, no relation, could use the ground-floor kitchen in addition to his own room. Mr. Beresford Brown found a good deal of junk left behind in the room, some of it actually the property of the young couple who'd spent a few nights with Christie. He cleaned the place up, and then, on March the 24th, looked around the walls for a suitable point to fix up brackets to hold a wireless. In the back wall, abutting on the washhouse and lavatory extension, Mr. Brown found a papered area which sounded like hollow wood when he tapped it. In small places it seemed to be just paper covering nothing at all. Mr. Brown carefully tore back a little of the paper at one of these gaps and shone his electric torch through the hole. Right in front of him in the darkness was a woman's half-naked corpse. She was seated on a pile of dirt and ashes with her back to Mr. Brown. Her head was bowed forward, but her back was held upright by a string from her bra that was tied to something above and in front of her. Her back and buttocks were bare and exposed, with heavy discoloration at the seat where her blood had drained. A suspender belt and stockings comprised the only clothing on her lower parts, but someone had stuffed an old vest into her crutch to act as a diaper. Mr. Brown couldn't believe his eyes, and rushed upstairs to get his neighbour, Mr. Ivan Williams, to confirm that he was seeing what he thought he was seeing. Mr. Williams looked at the shocking spectacle, and in the twinkling of an eye Mr. Brown was out of the house and over to tell the police what he had found. And so, Number 10 Rillington Place became one of the best-known addresses in England. The evening papers were rapidly full of the body found in Notting Hill, but nobody who was alive at the time and read the papers will ever forget the week of discoveries. Not just the tabloids of the day, the Daily Mirror and Daily Sketch, but papers which used to be respectable broadsheets, the Mail and the Express, and their excellent competitors, the News Chronicle and the Daily Herald, all led with the story of the Notting Hill murder, which became the Notting Hill murders, which became another body found in Notting Hill, which became Notting Hill murders, body found in the garden, and finally yet another body in the garden. And at the end of each movement of this crescendo of sensation, a photograph of the domed bald head and owlish spectacles, with the information that the police were anxious to interview the former tenant, Mr. John Reginald Halliday Christie. The Notting Hill murders were an instant crime classic, and Christie's full name and features were burned into the public memory during the week he was missing. So what had Mr. Beresford Brown opened up? A narrow alcove ran from the kitchen behind the washroom. It had once been used to store coals. Christie had used it to store bodies, and then closed its door and papered it over before handing the flat to the Rileys. The body Mr. Brown had seen was removed. It belonged to a young woman in her 20s. Her ankles were tied together with electric flex, her hands with a handkerchief, and she had been strangled with a ligature. The alcove was cool and dry, with air circulating through it despite Christie's papering, so that it was emitting little odour of decomposition. Behind it were two sinister bundles wrapped in blankets and corded, propped up against the wall. They, too, contained the bodies of strangled young women. They, too, had makeshift diapers thrust between their legs. They, too, were well preserved by the perfect conditions in the alcove, though one of them had been killed over a month previously. All were in excellent condition for post-mortem. Dr. Francis Camps, the pathologist, made two important discoveries. All three of these young women had carbon monoxide in their blood. They'd been gassed before they were strangled. And all three had semen in their vaginas. They had been ravished as they were killed. Would Mr. John Reginald Halliday Christie please come forward and help the police with their inquiries? The monster. A day later, searching the house, police found evidence of disturbance in the floorboards under Christie's front room window. They took them up, and there, well preserved in the space under the floor, was another body wrapped in a blanket. Another strangled woman. This time there was no trace of gas and no semen in the vagina, for this was Ethel Christie, last seen alive on December 12, 1952. Would her husband please come forward? Out in the garden, something was noticed that might have been spotted right back at the time of the Evans investigation. A piece of fencing was composed of old pickets and palings. At one point where it was giving way, a different strut had been used to prop it up. A human thigh bone. Soon the police were digging up the garden. Human bones came to light. The skeleton of a woman with her skull smashed into little pieces. The skeleton of another woman with her skull missing. Had anyone any knowledge of the whereabouts of John Reginald Halliday Christie? As if bad sexual taste could plumb even further depths than this mausoleum suggested, another discovery was made in the yard. An old tobacco tin containing four tufts of pubic hair taken from different women. Where was the curious collector, Mr. John Reginald Halliday Christie? On March the 31st, at 9:10 in the morning, P.C. John Ledger saw an unshaven tramp in a Trilby hat, dirty raincoat, and battered suit leaning over Putney Bridge.
"Are you out of work, chum?" asked P.C. Ledger. "Can you tell me who you are?"
"John Waddington, of 35 Westbourne Grove," was the answer. P.C. Ledger looked more closely.
"Would you mind taking your hat off?"
And with the brown Trilby removed, the familiar domed head and shining spectacles were revealed. The police had caught Christie. But who and what had they got on their hands?